In this segment, we'll start looking at the homework coding template for homework 4. All right, and that will be the 3D linear elasticity problem. It's the steady state problem, okay? So let's come over here to the code, and we'll look first at the main.cc file. And as you can see, almost nothing has changed from the previous homework assignment. I, of course, changed the name of the include file, but we still have, it's still 3D, passing in the mesh size. This is, for example, a 10 by 10 by 10 element mesh. Okay. Create our object and go through the same steps as before. All right, so we can go straight over to our header file. Now we have our same header files here, but now in this homework assignment, we are going to be using DL2's quadrature rules. We'll be using DL2's basis functions, and so that will make things a lot easier on the coding end of things, all right? But then it does change the structure of our code a little bit, all right? So we'll be looking at those changes here. First off, I'm going to declare order and quad rule as global variables. Actually, not variables, they're constants. I've designated that here that they're both constant integers. And I've done that because I've defined them here because I use both of these numbers in the constructor of some of our class objects, okay? So let's scroll down and look at the declaration of objects in our class, declaration of objects and functions. We have, of course, the same class constructor and destructor. Here I have a function called C. This is our elasticity tensor. Now, DL2 actually does have the capability of creating a fourth order tensor, which, of course, the elasticity tensor is. But I've set it up here as a function where the inputs are just the four indices and then it outputs that component of the tensor, okay? So you can use that when you're creating k-local. The solution steps themselves are all the same as well as these first three class objects, but now we have, again, the DL2 quadrature rules. We have two quadrature rules, a quadrature formula for volume integrals and a quadrature formula for surface integrals, which is the face quadrature formula. Okay, and we'll be showing you how to use those later on. Other than that, the KD and F matrices and vectors are the same. A slight change here, I've changed it this object, the table, instead of node location, it is DOF location, or the location of the degrees of freedom. And the reason I've done that change is because since this is 3D elasticity, we now have 3 degrees of freedom per node. And so there are 3 times as many degrees of freedom in the system as there are nodes. Okay, and this table gives you the location of each degree of freedom. So what that means is degree of freedom 0, 1, and 2, which all correspond to the same node, would have the same location, but they each have their own row within this table DOF location. Okay, of course, boundary values map is the same. I'll scroll down to the constructor and destructor. Here in the constructor, again, where we call the constructor for FE and DOF handler, but I'm also calling the constructor for quadrature formula and face quadrature formula. All right, because they need to know what the quadrature rule is. And so that's what you've defined up at the top. The default value is quad rule of 2. Leave it at 2 when you turn in your homework. But if you want to, you could easily change that to 3, 4, whatever. DL2 would automatically take care of that here. Also, you'll notice that I left order as a variable that can be defined. Again, I've defined it as 1 at the top. Leave it as 1 when you turn in your homework. However, feel free to, on your own, to change it to higher order basis functions if you'd like. DL2 automatically takes care of that, okay? But again, when you turn it in, leave it at order equals 1 and quad rule equals 2, okay? So those are the small changes in our constructor. Again, small change here with the output, the names of the output vectors, because, again, it's a vector field instead of a scalar field. Let's scroll down and look at this function C, which is the elasticity tensor. This is the first part that you actually have to edit something, and it's simply to input the values for the Young's modulus and the Poisson's ratio. From those values, I can reconstruct the lemma parameters lambda and mu. And with lambda and mu, I use the formula that you saw in the class, in the lectures, to find the particular component of the elasticity tensor. Now, if you recall, C is equal to lambda times your second order isotropic tensor, tensor product with, again, the second order isotropic tensor, plus 1/2 mu times the fourth order isotropic tensor. Okay, and what that means in conditional notation is that we have CIJKL equal to lambda times delta IJ times delta KL, where of course delta here is the Kronecker delta, where if I equals J, let me write that down here. Delta IJ is equal to 1 if I equals J, and 0 if I does not equal J. Okay? Sorry. Slight mistake up there. It should be 2 times mu instead of 1/2. Okay, so we have 2 mu, and then here we have 1/2 times delta IK delta JL plus delta IL delta JK. Okay? Of course, those can cancel out. And that's what you see in the code here. You notice I'm using these conditional statements here. If I equals J, if K equals L. If I equals J, then the condition is true, and so it returns 1. If I is not equal to J, then the condition is false, so it returns 0. So it's acting the same as a Kronecker delta. All right. So that it's a little bit cleaner and quicker than typing in an if statement, but it serves the same purpose in this case. All right. If we look at generate mesh, this is exactly the same as our 3D heat conduction problem. We simply have to define the limits of our domain, and it creates the mesh for us. All right, for define boundary conditions, again, this is something you'll fill in for yourself, and it will be very straightforward, similar to the previous assignments. Again, a slight difference here is that we're using DOF location instead of node location, but that's a small change. Another element that gets introduced here, though, is the fact that you may have different Dirichlet boundaries for each degree of freedom, for each nodal degree of freedom. And by that I mean you may want to fix on a certain face the displacements in the x direction, but not fix the displacements in the y or z direction. If that's the case, then in your if statement, you would check not only the location of the degree of freedom, but you'd also have to find out what's the corresponding nodal degree of freedom. In other words, is that degree of freedom a displacement in the x, y, or z direction? Okay, and so I've explained that a little bit here in the notes, in the template. However, you don't have to worry about that in this assignment, because our only Dirichlet boundary condition is to fix all degrees of freedom on the face where z equals 0. So all you have to do is check, is the z component of DOF location equal to 0? If it is, set that degree of freedom equal to 0, whether it's in the x, y, or z direction, okay? But in the future, if you want to, you actually can distinguish between displacements in the x, y, or z direction when you're applying Dirichlet boundary conditions. Okay? Let's quickly look at setup system. There's actually no difference here, other than the fact that we're creating DOF location as a table rather than node location. but nothing that you have to change. Okay, so we'll stop the segment here, and in the next segment we'll look at a symbol system, which again will be the meat of this template.